In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our hymn, printed in your hymnal, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. Our Lord Christ, good shepherd of the sheep, you seek the lost and guide us into your fold. Feed us and we shall be satisfied. Heal us and we shall be whole. Make us one with you, for you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Won't you be seated for the lessons?
Our first reading is from Acts chapter 4, beginning with the fifth verse. The next day, the rulers, elders, and scribes assembled in Jerusalem with Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. When they had made the prisoners stand in the midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name do you do to this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of the good deed done to someone who was sick and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which you must be saved." Here ends the first reading. The second reading is from 1 John, the third chapter, beginning with the 16th verse. "We know love by this, that Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses help? Little children, let us love, not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this, we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before him. Whenever our hearts condemn us, for God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from him whatever we ask because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, and that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he commanded us. All who obey us, his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us by the Spirit that he has given us." Here ends the second lesson.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 10th chapter. St. John writes, "Jesus said, 'I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because the hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. This is the gospel of the Lord." Won't you be seated? For the children's sermon, one of our kids who comes to the 8 o'clock service is really, truly into Disney princesses. And in fact, I've been doing this job for over 30 years, and with all the things that kids ask, she is the first kid to stump me. And her question was, who is your favorite Disney princess? And I have to admit, I blanked on that one. After a few minutes, I came up with Cinderella because I had seen it as a kid. But so she's really into princesses. So I wanted to try and give her something that would speak to that. And while I couldn't come up with a biblical princess, I could come up with a biblical queen who has an important story. So that biblical queen is Esther. And Esther has her own book in the Old Testament. And the story is that, of course, every Disney princess movie has to have a villain. Well, in this story, the villain is Haman, who wants all the Jews in the Persian Empire to be killed because he feels disrespected by Mordecai, who is Esther's uncle, who refuses to bow to him because he bows only to God. Well, Esther gets wind of this whole thing and tells the king, and the king ends up instead taking care of Haman. As happens at the end of every Disney movie, evil always loses, which would make a great transition also to the New Testament and talking about Jesus and evil losing. But so I wanted to bring to you Queen Esther, not a princess, but a queen. Purim is coming up on, Purim just happened. It is March 23rd and it was March 24th. So we just missed it by a little bit, but if somebody asks you about a Disney princess, you can always say, and I also know about a great queen, Queen Esther. By the way, I've got a few of these. If you want one, let me know on the way out. And now I invite you to again pray with me. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So today is the fourth Sunday of Easter, and every year in our three-year cycle of readings, the fourth Sunday of Easter is always Good Shepherd Sunday. Our hymns center around the theme of Jesus the Good Shepherd, as well as the blessing that is Holy Communion. Good Shepherd Sunday always involves reading a gospel lesson from the 10th chapter of John's Gospel, which is all about Jesus the Good Shepherd. And for congregations that read a psalm as part of their worship, the psalm is always the 23rd psalm, the Shepherd's Psalm, a beloved psalm. On this joyous Good Shepherd Sunday, we sing the hymns. Well, we just sang, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. And at the end of the service, we'll sing, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is. In the lessons, we hear that Jesus is the good shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep. The good shepherd knows the sheep, and the sheep know the good shepherd. The image of the shepherd is used frequently in the Old Testament, but in a way different than we might expect. In the Old Testament, the image of the shepherd is a royal image. It is the king of Israel or the king of Judah. Now remember, after the death of King Solomon, Israel splits into two, the northern kingdom, which is Israel, and the southern kingdom, which is Judah. But the king of either the united monarchy or of Judah and of Israel, the king is supposed to care for the people. Well, the king is supposed to be a good shepherd to the people, but for the vast majority of the kings, they were bad kings. They did not care about the people. They did not follow God's law. About 550 years before Jesus is born, the prophet Ezekiel will denounce all the kings who have failed to be good shepherds. They have been bad shepherds. God, Ezekiel announces that God will become the shepherd of the people. Since the kings had done such a terrible job of caring for the lost, the poor, and the sick. So when Jesus announces that Jesus is the good shepherd, Jesus is challenging both the Roman military administration and the Jewish Sanhedrin. Jesus will provide what the kings and the Roman administrators and the Judean high priest would not do. Jesus will care for the people. Jesus will love the poor and the outcast. Well, today the indictment continues to be that the rulers of the people do not care for the poor and the sick and the outcast. That is a problem to this day. Yes, there is some societal care for those in need, but can anyone argue that all public servants are really dedicated to the care of the poor and the hungry? I doubt anybody can really make that argument with a straight face. So what does this mean for Jesus the Good Shepherd? Well, I think we can take away three lessons. The first is that Jesus loves us. We can delight in the shepherd who seeks out the lost. We know that God loves us even those times when we go astray, when we are threatened by wolves. There are plenty of times when bad things happen to good people. It is then that we look to Jesus, our good shepherd. And when our lives are going well, we can look to the good shepherd who lays us down in green pastures and leads us beside still waters and who restores our souls. Well, second, we can do our best to stay part of the flock. Now, yes, if we get lost, Jesus the good shepherd will come looking for us. But isn't it better not to be lost in the first place? I know I hate being out there saying, oh, I hope someone finds me. I'm in a world of hurt. Put it another way, I remember when I was a little kid, I was learning to color with crayons, and I still remember being told, stay within the lines. The lines are your friends. It's heartbreaking when we find ourselves in trouble and we take a hard look, we say, you know what? I put myself in this predicament. Now things are going to be hard. I remember two lessons that I learned that I wish I did a better job of listening to. What would I do if I knew at that moment that my mother was watching? I think we all have had times when we look back and say, Mom had been there. It would not have gone that way. Or the other alternative question is, what would I do if I knew that my actions would be on the local news the next day? Once again, it's one of those, yeah, I probably wouldn't end up in as much trouble as I got in. So in short, stay with the flock. Listen to the voice of the shepherd, and the shepherd will not have to go searching after you. Now, we all sometimes wander, and Jesus will come looking, but at least in my life, I'd like that to happen as infrequently as possible. Well, third, Jesus loves all the people around us. Jesus is the good shepherd. Can we not also seek on our own to be shepherds of the world in which we live? Can we not, in Jesus' name, care for the poor and the outcast, the stranger and the sick? Now, exactly what that means to be shepherds to those around us, that varies. I'm always touched whenever I call somebody and say, you know, could you come in? Could you be part of a church meeting? Could you help us do some things at the church? And they say, No, I really can't because I'm driving someone to the doctor that day, and I think, okay, that's a good reason. We'll get you to come to church another day. I'm always touched when people tell me, you know, I'm going to be out delivering Meals on Wheels. I'm touched by anybody who's out there helping out in any number of ways, whether it's providing child care or cleaning or financial charity of any kind. The favorite thing I remember in my life that I did for a while, this was while I was in seminary, was helping kids learn how to read and reading to them and listening to them read. I haven't done that in a while, and I look forward to doing that again at some point. Now, we can never be the good shepherd, but we can bask in the love of the good shepherd. We can do our best to stay with the flock and not get lost. We can be, if not the good shepherd, we can be a good shepherd to some small number of those whom Jesus loves. We just sang our hymn, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. The fourth verse reads, early let us seek your favor, early let us do your will. Blessed Lord and only Savior, with your love our spirits fill. Blessed Jesus, you have loved us, love us still. So when you leave the church today, keep in mind the Good Shepherd. If you feel lost, look for the Good Shepherd to be looking for you. If you can't stay with the flock, listen to the voice of the Good Shepherd and be a good assistant shepherd. Amen. Our hymn, which is in your blue hymnal, is number 711. I invite you to rise.
You've lived, set this mind upon me.
Together we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed that you'll find on the fifth page of your bulletin. Together we confess. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. Shepherding God, gather your church whenever we wander from you and one another. Empower your church in ministries around the world to worship and serve alongside global companions as equal partners and co-workers in the gospel. Lord, in your mercy. Nurturing God, preserve the health of our earth. Inspire scientists, researchers, conservation organizations, and all people entrusted with the task of caring for creation, that we may be better stewards of the world around us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Almighty God, lead nations and communities to share resources, cooperate in solving conflicts, and listen to the opinions of indigenous peoples. Help all those with power to share it and to use such power for good. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Loving God, protect the very young and the very old, those living without housing, victims of domestic abuse, and all who live with chronic illness or compromised immune systems. Heal the sick. Guide communities to actively care for people who are vulnerable. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, help this and all communities of faith to listen for your voice. Call us away from things that distract us from following you. Invite us to more deeply love and serve people who are lonely, isolated, and on the margins. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Living God, we give thanks for our ancestors in faith, including Anselm of Canterbury, and all who labored to help generations understand the good news of the gospel. Strengthen us to share the good news in our own day. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also.
I invite you to be seated for music of the offering. I invite you to rise as we turn to the top of page 7 for the offertory prayer, and then we move into our communion service. Let us pray together. Risen One, you call us to believe and bear fruit. May the gifts that we offer here be signs of your abiding love. Form us to be your witnesses in the world, through Jesus Christ, our true vine. Amen. It is indeed right that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and ever-living God. But chiefly we are bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of our Lord, for he is the true Passover Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who by his death has destroyed death, and by his rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, we praise your holy name and join their unending hymn. And gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Assisting ministers. and then to come forward like going forward.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Please come forward. I invite you to rise. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you on to everlasting life. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, you gave your Son both as a sacrifice for sin and a model of the godly life. Enable us to receive him always with thanksgiving and to conform our lives to his through the same Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Hymn number 456 in your green hymnal.